Hello. Yes? Okay, great. Now I'm loud enough, apparently. Usually people are telling me to, you know, calm down and not speak too much or too loudly. So, you know. When people ask me who I am or what I do or what my job is, I actually have to stop and think a little bit, which is quite unusual because most of us are supposed to know exactly what we do, right? And then I tell people things like, well, I have a long and variegated past and present and maybe future. And they're sort of looking at me like, you know, what does that mean? The truth of the matter is that I have actually done many things, okay? Which has really helped my journey as a writer, because when you've done many things, you have a lot of stories to tell, right? And you have a lot of perspective into other people's stories, even though you may have sat on the sidelines for a while. It just makes it more perspective, more interesting, I should say, and gives you more perspective. And then I think, well, if I had to give a very accurate answer, I think it would be that in some way, shape, or form, I am the storytelling ambassador for India or South Asia. And what does that mean? Because everything that I have done professionally, or certainly personally, every, you know, ounce of interest that I have in living is to really tell the story of India. Currently, I am a journalist at Bloomberg. Financial journalist, right? It's a financial data services company. You know, what we do is distill the complexity of the financial markets and bring it to people. Okay, so where does India fit into that? I actually present and produce a program on Bloomberg Radio called First Word Asia, which is about Asia in general, Asian financial markets. My pet peeve is South Asia, because I have to keep reminding the rest of my colleagues, guys, this is First Word Asia. It's not First Word China show, okay? That is an important part of it. But we also have India, hello, and Southeast Asia, and South Asia, right? So that's my pet peeve, is to really bring to the surface, to the table, to the planet, to the audiences, the stories of India in my current job, the stories of Indian business, Indian finance. But before that, I used to work at RTHK Radio 3, public radio. So I had a lot more flexibility, a lot more freedom. And I had a show called Asian Threads, which was a storytelling show. Of course, that's what I do. That would really go into different parts of Asia and weave in sort of the complexities, the intricacies, you know, the untold stories that are out there, things that we might know about perhaps on the surface level, but, you know, we haven't gotten into in sort of more detail to get to their nitty-gritty, yeah? And then I write books. So today I brought 5 of my books. I've written 7 in total. This is over the course of, I would say, roughly the last 10 years. I think it was, yeah, right about 10 years ago when my first book was released, Inner Beauty, which I don't have here. I write fiction as well as nonfiction. From a nonfiction point of view, I have written 4 books on Ayurveda. Does anyone know what Ayurveda is? Yes? You're smiling. You know what Ayurveda is. Yes? What is it? It's from India, very good. What is it from India? Yeah, it's Indian medicine. Indian, kind of like traditional Chinese medicine is to China, Ayurveda is to South Asia. I have to say, having said that, I hate that metaphor, but I use it all the time. It makes it easier for me to explain it to many people out there in a nutshell, right? So I have four books that I have written about Ayurveda because in, not because, it started from sort of a, should I say, a past life of mine. When I was living in San Francisco, I had an Ayurvedic practice. I'm an Ayurveda clinician. I worked in the hospital there. So I would see patients and create Ayurvedic treatment programs for them. So excited to see you all that I'm choking. Excuse me. And I had a publisher come along and say, well, would you write a book on Ayurveda? And then that led to my first book on Ayurveda, which then led to the second, which then led to the third and then the fourth. So 4 books on Ayurveda. And then I've also, on the nonfiction side, written a book called Money Smart, An Indian Woman's Guide to Building Wealth. Excuse me. Sorry, I think the Hong Kong allergies are getting to me, that and the excitement of seeing you all. So, Money Smart is a book that is intended to be for the middle-class Indian woman. And I'll get into the specifics in a little more detail when we get into this topic of what is the spirit of South Asia. But I had a very interesting conversation once with Mrs. Moneypenny. Does anyone know who that is, Mrs. Moneypenny? Yes? No? Okay, she is a writer for a columnist for the Financial Times, and she puts together a column on the weekend, and I interviewed her once many years ago for one of my radio programs, and I said to her, excuse me, sorry. I said, Mrs. Moneypenny, why is it that so many people are afraid of the idea of finance? And she said, you know, I don't know, but so many people, you're right, are afraid of it, and I think it's absolutely wrong. And people need to have some knowledge. They don't have to be experts, but they need to have enough knowledge so that if they're seated next to Stuart Gulliver, who is the head of HSBC, at a dinner party, they'll have enough to talk about. And that got me thinking. I said, Mrs. Moneypenny, clearly I am going to the wrong dinner parties and you're going to the right ones. So, like, what is the secret there? We didn't get so much into that, but it did get me thinking about the middle-class Indian woman, which is another one of my pet peeves, right? Because when they think of the word finance, they think of it as the F word. Oh, I don't want to touch it. Oh, no, my husband will take care of all that. My father used to take care of all that. My son will take care of all that. And I'm like, what is this nonsense? You go from living this life of dependency from your father to your husband to your son? Pet peeve, pet peeve. So I wrote this book for that woman, okay? And those are my nonfiction books. And then I also have two fiction books that I have written. These are both young adult fiction. Although I think the way we classify young adult fiction in India has got to be a little bit different to how young adult fiction is classified elsewhere in the world. When Arya Fell Through the Fault is actually my first fiction book that I wrote. It took me a long time to write it because there's a lot of Indian philosophical concepts that are sort of layered into it. It's not a philosophy book, it's a kid's book, okay? It's about a preteen boy who falls through a crack in the floor in San Francisco and finds himself in the forests of ancient India. And it's sort of a classic hero's journey. No spoilers, I won't tell you, right? He finds himself in the land of the Ramayana, okay, which is one of our ancient, epics in India, filled with various mythology, small stories of mythology that are sort of put together in this one massive epic, if you will. And I have always been fascinated by our epics because, one, they are epic. I mean, they're epic. They're huge. 7,000 verses more. I think that's the shorter one. The other one that we have, the Mahabharata, is even longer, right? And then by the fact that in South Asia, there are so many different versions. We tend to think of the Ramayana, if I'm to dwell on that for a second, as an epic that was written by a sage called Valmiki. It's sort of very standard the way we've been taught. But the truth of the matter is, his rendition was just one rendition of the Ramayana. There are lots of household manuscripts in the north, south, east, west, okay, which you can still find today on sort of these like ancient papers and things like that. And of course, like anything, there is overlap, but each Ramayana story has its own sort of version, its own take, its own digression. This fascinated me, okay? So I wanted to create a story that sort of explored what would happen if a boy today, if a child today, fell into that land, which we all think of as something in the past, but who says it's something in the past? Who says it doesn't exist? I mean, the land is there, right? There are characters in the story who the story says are immortal. Immortal means they're here somewhere, right? They're still walking the earth as far as we were told. So what if he ran into some of them? And that's sort of what inspired that story. Operation Mom, How I Got My Mother, A Life and a Man. Completely different, completely the opposite. Also young adult. This is the perspective of a 17-year-old girl in contemporary Mumbai, okay, who, to get her mother, her nagging Punjabi mother, off her back, decides to set her up on a date. Her mother's single, okay? Her mother's single. No spoilers. So she, over one summer, decides to embark on this mission to find her mother a date. This is pretty untraditional. It's sort of taking the Indian tradition and turning it topsy-turvy, because usually it's the mother who's looking for a date for her daughter. Not a date, but a husband. I wanted to get away from that. I said, let's forget husbands. Let's just focus on dating, okay? There's a reason. We'll talk more about that. But if the mother is single, for whatever reason, why should the daughter not set her up on a date? So the daughter embarks with her silly friend on this crazy mission where they go online to find her an online date, but the online world can be very precarious, right? There are all sorts of weirdos out there. This is Mom after all. If I land her with a weirdo, oh my God, I'm gonna be responsible. So they embark on this rather hilarious journey where they check out these dates and find them in their real lives to investigate them to make sure that they're okay. And it leads to a lot of hilarious adventures. So there are quite a few different kinds of stories, whether you're looking at fiction or nonfiction, but they're all about South Asia. I mean, that's my shtick. I don't know. You know, people say that writers can put themselves in any situation and they can imagine, and, you know, I can write a story about, you know, whatever, life on the North Pole, and maybe that's true. Hasn't happened for me. Hasn't worked for me so far. I don't think maybe I've tried or tried enough. I'm very happy with South Asia. There's a lot to explore. There's a lot to tell. And as I said a little bit earlier, there's a lot that people just don't know, right? When I was growing up, sort of in the 70s and 80s, it was like, oh, yes, it's the land of elephants and snake charmers. And, you know, that was a real drag. I found myself in the US as a college student. I was like, what is this nonsense, you know? Today, it's about, oh, the Indian techie and, you know, the computer whiz brain. And that is true. And we are very proud of that. Let me make no mistakes about that. But there's more. There's so much more, right? So all of my stories, in some way, shape, or form, look into this thing which I call the spirit of South Asia, okay? Because there is a unique spirit that is an underlying thread that ties all these stories, at least mine, I think, together in some way, shape, or form, right? So since we're a small group, I'd like to, and it's more fun, you know, when we keep things interactive, I'd like to throw this out to you, to ask you, what is your perspective on the spirit of South Asia? What does that mean to you? Anyone? What is the spirit of South Asia as you understand it? And then we can compare notes. Yes? Anyone? No? No one? No one? Come on, I don't believe that. Someone, I have to call and pick on people otherwise, like a teacher. Yes?
To succeed.
That's an interesting one, absolutely. Why? You know, these annoying presenters, they always ask why as a follow-up question.
Well, the ones that I know always work hard, really work hard workers.
Absolutely. Does anyone disagree with that? I think that's very true. The spirit of South Asia, from time immemorial, certainly has been to succeed. Whatever it is that you put your mind to, a lot of this in the last 100 years, maybe 50 to be more accurate, 50, 60, is because of lack of economic opportunity. You know, I came from a generation of people that had to, when I say had to, you know, we thought that the only way forward for us was to leave India and go abroad, whether it be to the West, whether it be to UK or to the United States of America, because that's where our destiny would unfold. That's where we would be able to prosper. That's where we would be able to better our existence. And a lot of us did. Interestingly enough, our children's generation are doing the opposite. Not all of them, but a lot of them are thinking, you know, we've got to get back to South Asia because that's where the economic opportunity is. That's where I can succeed. That's where I will succeed. And so parents, why did you make sure I was shafted out of that, you know? It's interesting. I think with South Asia, there has always been this sense, you know, from time immemorial of, this is my land, I'm in a place, I'm in a space which I need to have ownership of, but I do not. Why? Because there's a colonial ruler. Or why? Because there's a Western economic better. Or why? Because, you know, there is a marketplace, perhaps, where things from the outside are appreciated more than what we make inside. So how am I going to change this? India today is not the India that I certainly grew up in, okay? My husband and I argue about this a lot because he lives fixated in this idea of Mumbai, where we're both from, in the 70s, which is a lovely place to live in your head, okay? I do not deny that. But the guy gets culture shock every time he's back, poor thing. You know, I'm like, hello, okay? Because India today is flooded with media, flooded with multimedia. The finance industry's gone crazy. The city, Mumbai, the city that I grew up in, that we grew up in, is completely different, you know, in terms of where the commerce and where the industry is and how the residential areas have developed as a result, okay? These are all examples of, as you say, the Indian spirit, the South Asian spirit, continually succeeding. Succeeding, and that leads to change. Succeeding, and that leads to change. Okay? So every time us foreign Indians now, non-resident Indians, go back, we see that change, we see that success. You know, we're happy, and of course we want to continue to be part of it. So yes, I would say to succeed, success is very much part of the spirit of South Asia. What else? Who else would like to contribute?
Resilience.
Why? Follow-up question.
Because they would always struggle to sort of, get over.
Struggle?
I mean, they would always struggle to get over, any catastrophe, So.
South Asians have had to battle a lot of catastrophe, yes, time and time again. And it's getting over that. So this is tied to the succeeding, right? Getting over that in order to move ahead. Can you give me an example for of a catastrophe? Perhaps one in the recent past, yeah.
Maybe, for example, the tsunami, a natural disaster, or maybe the wars, in Pakistan and in India.
Yeah.
Or maybe in Sri Lanka, for example.
Exactly.
We still, have overcome.
There is very much, you're absolutely right, the spirit of we shall overcome. In fact, we have a national song which sort of sings to that, speaks to that. For thousands of years, I mean, it's not just recently, India, South Asia has always been in this state of war, if you will, of battle, because it has traditionally, before it became a British colony, it was like the land of provinces and empires, all of them battling for power, for territorial power, I should say, control, you know? And you lose one battle, that doesn't faze you. It's very much the spirit of, okay, I shall overcome. I had a fascinating interview on Friday this week, last week, I should say. This was with Sri Gopichand Hinduja, who is the head of a very well-known Indian conglomerate. He is an Indian man, of course. He is actually based in England. Okay, so we did this interview over a conference call. He was in England and I was here. And his family group of companies is 100 years old. Okay, it started off in Iran 100 years ago by his grandfather. Okay, and because he went, talking about to succeed, he went to Iran to search for opportunity and set up what was a trading business at the time, which is today a mix of trading and real estate and banking and media and so much more, right? And the one thing that he said, Gopi Chand Hinduja, is really, really has stuck with me, because he said, if you look at the word impossible, it's derived from possible. Okay, so there is no such thing. He says, if you look at the creator of the light bulb, okay, think about how many times he had to fail in order to eventually succeed. He said, I have met with failure umpteen times in my life, but that doesn't faze me. It doesn't stop me. It doesn't put me into a state of depression, because only when I am faced with that failure do I know that there is yet another chance to succeed. Okay, so he says, I look at challenges not as stones or hurdles, but rather as stepping stones to success. And that is very, very much an example of the indomitable will that is the spirit of South Asia, the resilient will, you know, to succeed. So thank you both. Those are great examples. Who else has a great example? I know it's lurking out this side of the room. Yes, come on. Yes? Yes? You're about to say something. I can see it. It's just coming out.
The spirit of South Asia.
What does that mean to you?
Do you mean it's exclusive to South Asia, or do you mean...
I don't think the spirit of South Asia necessarily has to be exclusive to South Asia, or I should say anymore. And I should add to that, I think other... areas, people, cultures might have certain aspects of spirit which overlap with what I think perhaps is the spirit of South Asia. So, yeah, no, what's going through your head?
Well, I think that, I mean, looking from the perspective of the whole world, I think we all have our own failures. We all have to persevere through the challenges, and we all have to be resilient through them. I mean, looking in, for example, in America, there was the American dream, the idea that through perseverance, you can achieve anything that's possible. I mean, despite the fact that it's died down nowadays, it's, the American dream isn't so prominent there. There's still that sort of put in the effort and you can succeed. So I don't think it's exclusive to the spirit of South Africa. I think there's a commonality that's shared between everybody in the world.
So when I go back to the example of the people of my generation who actually left India to go to America to pursue the American dream, what about that? Why were we not pursuing it back home when clearly today people are?
Well,
I'm not putting you on the spot. Anyone? Anyone want to help out? Thoughts?
Religion?
Say again, sorry.
Your religions and your mystery stories.
Mysterious stories or mythical stories?
Mysterious
stories. Yeah. Mysterious stories. Yeah, mysterious perhaps only because they are yet to be uncovered by those who don't know about them, right? That's our job, to help through that process, yeah? And religion is an interesting one. Do you mean religion or do you mean spirituality?
Religion and your class. You have different level of class, right? Yeah.
Social strata?
Yeah.
Okay, definitely we should talk about that one. Yeah. Okay, but to your point, the dream exists. I do agree with you. I don't know whether it's the American dream, but that idea of the dream, and I think it's definitely, again, tied into what was brought up earlier about resilience and the desire to succeed. So yes, I do think that does exist. The context, perhaps, for South Asia is a little bit different, and that's what I want to get in, meaning how we achieve that, how we actually go forward to those next steps. So I do want to address that a little bit. But let's talk about religion and spirituality first, because I think sort of that's part of it, yeah? A lot of the times when people are talking about Hinduism, it's sort of labeled as this sort of complex religion, and you've got all these different social classes, and you get into the caste system, and that's a bad thing because, you know you're socially ostracized and categorized and all of that kind of thing. I have to say, sort of as an ambassador of, you know, Indian stories, of, you know, for lack of any better title, a lot of that idea of the caste system and the social classes has evolved in the last 300 years, okay? Maybe a little bit more than that, 300-400 years. If you look at the Vedic origins of what today we call Hinduism, okay, the Vedic religions, it's very much about a way of life, okay? A way of life for everybody, a way of life that is unique to all, okay? Ayurveda, which is sort of my specialty, okay, is an Indian medicinal, a South Asian medicinal system that derives from the Vedas, okay? And here, the emphasis is very much on spirituality. It's not religion as much as spirituality. I'd really like to get into what is the difference. Spirituality, again, gets back to that, what is the spirit, right? Religion, to me, is much more sort of a system of, let's say, the higher power, the higher being, the God that I ascribe to, that I believe in, that works for me on a daily basis or whatever it is, okay? That may be my Hindu gods, my Muslim, you know, prophet, Christianity or whatever. We're a very diverse country, India, that is, okay? We accept all religions, okay? But religion is different from spirituality. Spirit in, you know, when I think of the South Asian spirit, and I keep having to stop myself and go back to saying South Asian because it's really that part of the world. It's not in today, what is India is still a relatively new concept if you look at the history, right, of the region. South Asia, okay, there is very much this belief in mind-body, okay, and how you can't separate the two, okay? The example that I always like to look at is that of a coin. When you've got a coin, you've got the heads and you've got the tail, right? So you can't really separate the heads from the tails. I could break the coin into two and then I'd have two halves of the same coin, but they would still have a head and a tail. So you have half the head, half the tail, half the head, half the tail to make up what was the original coin. And I can keep breaking the coin and the same thing just continues to happen. I still have the heads and the tails, okay? So the reason I decided to write my books on Ayurveda initially was to explain to the world that, you know, when we think of medicine, it's not something that is separate from what happens in the mind. It's not a physical thing only, okay? I'm coughing today, okay? I have been a little bit under the weather, okay, and I am very susceptible to allergies, okay? That is, sounds like, and it is, a very physical thing, okay? But very much connected to that, okay, what is allergies? Let's just look at that example for a second. What is allergies? Anyone?
Yes, I'm sure
somebody can tell me what allergies are.
The
overreaction. Okay, it's an overreaction. Is it a quick reaction or a slow reaction?
Quick reaction.
Right? Why do you say it depends?
There are different types of diseases, well, allergies that occur at different rates.
So yeah, okay, okay. So perhaps there was a slow build-up because maybe I didn't have allergies when I was a kid, but now I quickly react. I'm not reacting to you, I promise that, okay? But, so physically, I perhaps doesn't make me feel so great. Emotionally, what does that mean for me? Do I feel, emotionally very happy, but then I have these physical allergies? And those are two separate things. Does that make sense? Yeah? No. Why not? So if I am coughing or sneezing or quickly reacting, then it's not going to make me feel too good, you know, emotionally either, right? Also, it is highly likely that if I have a quick reaction to whatever it is, pollution or pollen or whatever it might be, dust, then I'm also going to have a quick reaction to you, that's a bad example, someone else, okay? I have reacted to pollen or pollution because I don't like the pollution, hence I'm coughing or sneezing or my nose is feeling itchy. Not a good feeling. If I don't like this person, I'm also going to have a quick reaction. It may not be in the form of an itchy nose, but whatever it is, it's going to be a quick reaction, a quick judgment call, whatever you want to call it. That emotional judgment call, okay? Heads cannot be separated from tail. The emotional is not separated from the physical, okay? So a lot of diseases, when we look at them and we break them down in the context of Indian medicine, is we're looking to understand the emotional aspect of it and the physical aspect of it. When we treat depression, all right, in the realms of Ayurveda, okay, what we look to do in the context of an Ayurvedic wellness center is we try to physicalize the symptoms of depression through a lot of physical treatment. So what ends up happening is people who are depressed, emotionally depressed, they end up being very congested. And, oh, well, what was that about? I wasn't congested before. No, what we're doing is working to slowly and gradually turn that into a physical form. Why? Because when it is physical, then it can be more easily ejected, expelled from the physical body through your natural body processes. That is, in a nutshell, Ayurveda. No, that's saying it too mildly. I just would like to be a spokesperson for it. So that's just one example, yeah? What I'm trying to elicit is that heads cannot be separated from tail. If I'm to put that same head-tail example into the context of, let's say, fiction, let's say when Arya fell through a fault, okay? This is a story about a 12-year-old boy who, guess what, reacts, okay? Anger, petulance, impetuousness, okay? I don't like this, I'm just gonna get really angry and react. So in school, you know, he doesn't deal well with bullies because the bullies come at him, he reacts. And that gets the bullies going, and then it's constant, like this spiraling thing. How many times have we seen this in our daily lives? In our own lives, perhaps, when we were kids, in our kids' lives, in the lives of other kids around us, yeah? It's a constant, ongoing thing, right? Now, Arya finds himself in the land of the Ramayana, okay? And he comes across a sage, an ancient sage, who is purportedly still walking the earth. So one of you might run into him today. If you do, please let me know, because I'm always researching, okay? And this particular sage was the trainer, warrior trainer, I should say, for Ram and Lakshman, who are sort of the star characters, if you will, of the Ramayana, okay? And took them through years and years of arduous warrior training so that they could eventually sort of deal with the demons in battle, the Ravan, the ten-headed demon, okay? So Arya comes across the sage, and the sage decides to put him through some aspect of warrior training. But in the West, when we think of what a warrior must do, a warrior must attack, right? Attack the enemy. If you've got the enemy, how are you going to defeat the enemy if you don't attack the enemy? Over here, the warrior is, the teacher is teaching him something different. He's like, no, don't attack, because you do that already. That, in effect, is your problem, because you react, and therefore you attack, okay? And then it sends you into this spiraling situation. What you need to do is restrain. And Arya, this poor kid, is thinking, well, then what kind of a warrior am I going to be if I restrain? If there's a demon, I've got the demon in my face, should I be not pulling my arrow against the bow and setting it off to go and kill the demon or go and attack the demon? And there's a time and a place and a space for everything, okay? But what Arya needs to learn is restraint, okay? You don't just attack the demon at first sight. You don't just react at first sight, okay? You got to understand that you only have limited arrows in your quiver. So the sage who is training him only gives him 3 arrows. And through his journey, he has to learn when it is most opportune to use those arrows, because only if he uses them at the opportune moment will they actually be powerful, and will he be able to address the situation, i.e. of eliminating the demon or whatever it is. Again, no spoilers, okay? If you actually react too quickly just because there is a so-called demon in sight, well, guess what, folks? Demons are in sight every day, okay? They walk the earth much more than, you know, the 12 immortals we have in Vedic mythology that are quite circumspect and keep themselves hidden most of the time, right? Demons walk the earth every day and are in your face every day. So if you're going to react too quickly at every single one, you're going to have no arrows left, one, and you're probably going to create more of a situation, more of a ruckus than anything else. So for Arya, it's very much this whole mind-body education, again, of how to be the intrinsic warrior, how to be the true warrior, right? The warrior who is physically able to be successful in battle once he is able to tie in his emotional mastery of the weapons with the physical mastery of the weapons as well. Mind, body. Heads, tails, two sides of the same coin, cannot be separated. Okay? So, oh wow, time is rolling along. Okay. Going on to sort of a different aspect of the spirit of South Asia. In two of my books, I address sort of my pet peeve is women, I've said earlier. My nonfiction book, Money Smart, my fiction book, Operation Mom, where the daughter is setting up the mother on a date, okay? This is taking things the way they are. Excuse me. And turning them on their head a little bit, okay? This idea of that I spoke about a little bit earlier about the woman, the Indian woman being dependent, shifting from this dependency of father to husband to son, okay, again has existed, I won't say from time immemorial, but certainly in the last perhaps 100 years, okay? And even today, a little bit too much. I gave a presentation recently to an internal presentation to the people in my company, Bloomberg, people in the Mumbai office, and this was specifically about managing your finances. Okay, so quite different from what we're talking about today. And the organizer of the presentation asked me, she said, okay, I know you've written this book about personal finance and that's, you know, targeted towards women. So the group you want to address, is that for women only or is that going to be, you know, for a co-ed group? And I said, no, we can do either way. You know, I'm happy to do a co-ed group. What do you think? She's like, no, well, we've got short time, so we can't do two. So let's, if it's okay with you, have men and women. I said, yeah, of course, it's fine. Ironically, however, what happened was it was a small group. It was about 20 people and very interactive session, but only the men talked. Okay, only the men talked. Okay, and I was literally at them with there was no mic in that situation. I was like, come on, women, come on, say something. You know, it's like, you know, I'm the one who's doing the attacking now, you know. But the women didn't want to talk. And I find this too often in the South Asian context. Do we find this in other Asian contexts or in other non-Asian contexts? Anyone help me out? I have less experience with that. Yeah? No? Are the women, all women in the room, will you talk? Will you express your views and opinions as much as the guys? Asians are generally more quiet. Why? Why is that? Okay. How have we been brought up? Asians. Yeah. How have Asians been brought up as compared to, let's say, non-Asians? That. Okay, so when you're young, you're expected to not say too much, be polite. Okay, what about the guys, though? How come they don't? Were they not?
It's not a gender issue for Asians. It's more Asians compared to Western people.
Okay, so then I'm talking about a room filled with Asians, actually Mumbaikars, people from Mumbai, where we're talking about personal finance. But like the guys had the opinions and the women wouldn't say anything. And I was like, come on. So why is that happening? And does that happen in other Asian contexts or non-Asian contexts? No? Yes? Yes? It is a gender issue.
Yeah, because from childhood, like, boys and girls are brought up in a different way.
Okay. What is that difference?
Because, I mean, for example, let's say for a guy, I mean, I was brought up in an Asian country. I mean, I didn't have a curfew to come home, but my sister, she did have. I mean,
oh, yes.
Things like that.
Oh, yes.
I mean, so that's an example. So
I feel your sister's pain so deeply. You have no idea.
Yeah, but the thing
she
is...
She does.
Yeah, but no, because now what I see is because of that, things are changing. For example, like my sister has a daughter, but she has about 3 daughters now. But she want to, you know, change... I mean, she doesn't want her daughters to go through the same thing. And things are changing. You could
absolutely
see that.
Yeah. You're absolutely right. You're both right. I mean, as Asians, we're taught a certain way and you behave in a certain way. And there, I think gender issues are ingrained in the way we are brought up. You know, fortunately or unfortunately, I say both because there are pluses and minuses to both. I mean, the reason I have taken up women as a topic is not because I'm a feminist. Actually, I'm probably the last person in the world who is a feminist. But it's, you know, I don't think that women anywhere, and my context being South Asia, need to go from this dependency of father to husband to son. It's wrong. Yes, yes.
I also want to, since you're brought up in US, I also wanted to ask this question ever since. Why, like, I was in a class and we had friends who were very loud. They were from US. Like, for us, everyone said, why they're so loud? Why they have to, like, have opinion for everything? We also have opinion, but we are, like, it doesn't mean we are quiet, doesn't mean we don't have opinion. But I always had that question in my mind because my friends would always have a, like, think, why they're so annoying, irritating, and that's the opinion of Asian towards the Americans or the way you were brought up or how you're brought up. But I wouldn't take it that way because it just, like you said, why women are so submissive and why are quiet, it's the how you see it. We also see the same way, that you're so loud and you're so on the face.
Yep.
We see, if you see that way, we can also see that way, but that's not the way to see, I think. The perspective is very wrong, I think. Because the way you're brought up is correct for you, the way they're brought up from that way, they're correct for themselves. So who are we to judge like that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, any reactions to that? Anyone? Because yes, you're laughing. How about,
I also want to ask one more, like, person who reacts first doesn't make the right reaction, doesn't mean like he's reacting everything is right all the time. Maybe people just watch, observe, like you said, you use the right quiver to use, and just because maybe the guys are more reactive and the girls love to use the quiver at the right time, that doesn't make it.
Oh, I love that. I'm going to use that. I will give you credit. I don't know where, but I'm going to use it for sure.
No, like, it's, and because he said, like, because of girls and guys are brought up, I've brought up in girls' school. And that was not even an issue for me. Like, some were quiet, some were loud. I would always answer. And when I went out from girls' school, then only I realized there's an issue called guys are behave differently, girls. Because I didn't know. I thought everyone's same. So what's the difference?
Absolutely.
So I think you have to stop categorizing for everything. Because I'm from, because I really find it, like, my friends were really annoyed with, you know, because... someone for, because they were very loud, but I could understand. That's the way we're brought up. And the same way, why they're so quiet?
Yeah.
They were annoying, what's the way? But that's not the way to, like, it's just the way are things.
Yeah.
So I think it's very wrong. And also about, sorry, I was late because I wanted to, like, see how, and for the South Asian spirit, for me, is a, like, legacy. That's a very beautiful, and for me, I don't know this. Legacy is a very important word for South Asian. And if I have to symbolize them, I would say when I see South Asian, I see as a tree. Tree for some are saying like a stopping or something. For me, why you said that, why they go back again? Because tree are very rooted, deep rooted. And why they explore to the US or anyway? Because they love to branch out. They are very...
She's great. Where did you find her from? Can I keep her? Please. Will you come home with me?
No, that's very appropriate because you're like, why you're digging to Ayurveda? Because you're deeply rooted. Why you went to work? Because they love to explore. So South Asian are very deeply rooted. That's why your kids go back to the root. And they love to branch out. They are very adventurous. You see, like Chinese or all Asian in US, because they love to branch out. You can't blame your parents for going out. Why this and that? That's a very wrong way to see. You can say that your parents are very daring, adventurous. They love to branch out. And they found out, okay, but we still can go back to root. If they hadn't made that root, how would you know that the root is stronger than the branches?
Absolutely. If I'm to go further, and yes, I agree. Let's everyone give her a hand. I love the metaphor of the tree. And if I'm to sort of just take that and build on it and put it into context, the tree that I'm envisioning is a banyan tree, because the roots actually drop down and branch out. Not the roots, it branches out, you know, from the branches. So, and the thousands and thousands of years old, and these trees are really a home for everybody in the forest, all sorts of birds, all sorts of animals. A very diverse community is what I'm saying.
Sorry, the money as well. And also for the money, why the, I also want to have, is it okay?
Yeah.
Like you said that why the guys only spoke, why not the girls? Because you have to remove that issue that just because the girls are not more interested in money does not make them like, I think the perspectives, a lot of things, if you keep on building that perspective, it goes to the women's head. Like, I wanted to ask that, what about men? Men do not need education about the money.
Oh, they do.
That's why you saw everyone talk, because men do not know, first of all. So don't expect the women, if they are dependent. If the man was strong, he would definitely teach the women. That means the man is the one who needs the education first.
Okay. We've got more books in the making here.
No, that's a different way of looking at things, because you're saying one perspective. It can be various perspective, one of my perspective, and there can be various perspective as well. So I think it's nice that I can share, that's all.
Of course it is. Anyone else? Would anyone else like to share? Just keeping a track of the time here. When I look at Operation Mom, How I Got My Mother a Life and a Man, okay? This is a comedic book. It's a lot of contemporary humor that you find in Mumbai. It was a very interesting journey to actually develop this book because I grew up as a 17-year-old in Mumbai. So I thought, oh, I was a 17-year-old in Mumbai. I'm gonna write a book about a 17-year-old girl in Mumbai. Well, guess what? You know, like whatever, 30 years, 35 years later, it ain't that easy, okay? You're out of context. Just with your slang, the lingo, the understanding of teen issues, all of that. So there was a lot of research, active research involved. All of a sudden, you know, I was in all of these teen groups talking to these teenagers in Mumbai, and they're like, you know, you're a weirdo. Like, why are you showing up and asking all these questions? So, and I'm like, well, because, you know, I don't know what I want to be when I grow up, so I like hanging out with you, you know, to get real perspective. How do I say that, I'm thinking in my head, in a way that doesn't sound make me sound like I'm some old idiot, which I am and I'm okay with, but you know, to them, so that they will share with me. It was quite interesting. And I had to take bus rides. These are the old bus routes that I would take as a kid, but I went back and now took as an adult just to see if the people looked the same, behaved differently, what they were talking about, what was going through people's heads, what were the issues. What were they fighting with the bus conductor about? Was the bus conductor around? You know, that was like a fixture, you know, in my childhood, the bus conductor, you know, and how we would get into fights with him all the time, all of us. We were bad children. But I was happy to find children are still bad. I believe the children should be bad because, you know, then everything is great after that. But it was interesting to sort of research this book, and it was also interesting to sort of break these boundaries a bit, because a single woman in India is still something that is very much looked down upon, okay? Whether you are single because you never got married, oh, You never entered the institution of marriage. You must be a bad person. Or you're single because you got divorced. Whatever the circumstances might have been, it's your fault. Okay? It is your fault that you are divorced. That mentality still exists till today. Okay? A person like me sort of takes it all for granted because on one hand, I live outside of India, so when I go back, it sort of frustrates me to sort of see my single female colleagues or companions or friends or whatever in that situation. It's like, why is society looking down? Like, okay, so you're single, so what? You know, what's the big deal? But it is a big deal, okay? Because again, we are a culture, again, we are a society that is very tradition bound, okay? And these traditions, wonderful as they are and can also be shackles, okay? That sort of hold you back. So that's why I decided to explore this idea of the daughter saying, okay, you know what? I'm going to set up the mother, okay? Because mother is single. Let's see where this can go. And I decided to rope in a lot of my old childhood haunts. So there's a lot of, you can say me in it in some way, shape, or form, because these are sort of places that I explored as a child. But taking that idea and turning it around, okay, which is again going back to that idea of the South Asian spirit, which is very much what you guys touched upon, was to succeed and to be resilient. Because if something is not working for me culturally, or if I am bound by these traditions and cannot live a life of independence or freedom or live that dream that you were talking about, achieve that dream, then I've got to break it. I've got to break those shackles somehow, okay? But I've got to do it in a way that still respects sort of the rules of society, whatever those rules might be, okay? Even if my objective is perhaps maybe to break one or two of those rules or more, three or four, whatever it might be, I've got to do it in a way where I am not this warrior on the attack, but warrior restrained, knowing when to shoot my arrow, knowing the best time to do it, the best way to do it, the best way to find my target, okay? Because then, and only then, will I succeed and be able to move to the next level. Yeah, that is very, very much the spirit of South Asia. So, given where we are on time, I think we've definitely had some interaction, which is great, but I'd like to throw this out to some questions from you. This is your time, so please do ask questions. Don't be shy like those people in that presentation. Whether you're male or female, doesn't matter. Okay, so we'll have a little bit of time for Q&A, and then I am around to chat further, sign books if you'd like any books or whatever you would like. So how about questions? Who has a question? What am I working on now? Okay, that is the deep question that I must not avoid, right? I am working, book-wise, of course. I'm working on another young adult novel. This is going to be a little bit different. It's about three 17, 18-year-old boys on a summer holiday in Devlali, which is a hill station in India, which used to be a sanitarium because the air was very clean. So, you know, during the time that India was a British colony, the soldiers would go there to recuperate if they were sick. But so it's a story of kinship between these three guys, and I'm sort of halfway through it. And unlike Operation Mom, where I knew what was going to happen, it's like I knew what was going to happen. I could see it in my head, and it was unfolding, and I was doing all this research, and I was there, and it happened. More like when Arya fell through the fault, which I sort of knew overall kind of where somehow I wanted to go with this. But I, you know, the story developed as I dug into it. This one I'm very much developing as I dig into it, because what we're told as young adult authors in general is you explore the romance theme, because that's what young adults like. Or there's got to be something drastic, meaning a mystery or an event or a mishap or something that draws the readers into the story, okay? I am sort of, the reason I set it in Devlali is because it's a little slower than sort of mainstream Indian city like Mumbai or Delhi or something like that. And when I was a young adult, I was very much fascinated, like many Indian young adults, by the stories of R.K. Narayan. Anyone familiar with those? Our stories of R.K. Narayan? Yeah? This R.K. Narayan, wonderful author, English author, you should check him out, wrote stories about life in an Indian village. And they're quite funny, but dry, sarcastic, not sarcastic in the sense of like British sarcasm, but sort of a wry humor. The pacing, very slow, because a lot of it was descriptive about what was happening in the village, which to the average person today is not necessarily exciting or fast, right? Look at our lives, like far removed from a village. But he is very masterful in the way he's able to bring about, you know, the personality quirks and the thought processes of his characters. So we're told, the reason I'm coming back to this is, as young adult authors, we're told the pace has got to be really quick. Everybody has ADHD. The kids all have ADHD, go from this to the next, to the next, to the next. The plot has got to be super fast and super organized. And I don't know that I necessarily agree. I'd like to ask you, because I'm halfway through the book, would you like to see a very fast-paced young adult novel set in Devlali about three guys, three friends? We're not, we may not be young adult anymore, but at some level, I think, I'm going to speak for all of us. We still have that young adult, we were there. We're not necessarily fossils. This is where I try and, my kids, of course, it doesn't work with them because they're like, oh, you're an old fogey, you don't know anything, you're not qualified to talk about anything, you're not hip. You can't use the word hip because apparently that's not hip, that's not used. So stuff like that. When I write young adult novels, they're not necessarily for young adults. What I mean by that is if you think of J.D. Salinger and Catcher in the Rye, that's a book that you can read over and over again. Right, To Kill a Mockingbird, any of those literary fiction young adult classics, if you will. Yeah, that's sort of more along the lines of what I'm thinking for this particular book. But I'm really interested in knowing from you whether you agree that the pacing should be fast, 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 fast. Or are you interested in sort of perhaps understanding more of the intricacies on a slower pace, you know, as to what happens and how characters unfold and plots unfold. Anyone?
Speaking from a young adult perspective.
Yes, we like
I'm
to hear that.
Actually a high schooler from the States. And I've read Catcher in the Rye and I've read Toni Morrison, some of her books. And I would say I like going back and reviewing and getting a different perspective, because the first time you read it, it's you get the main gist of it, but the second time you get the tiny details the author leaves behind, and I think that's really insightful, and it's very inspiring too, I would say.
Okay, that's great to know. Thank you for that. We need to clone you, firstly, and I hope you'll find that with When Arya Fell Through the Fault as well, exactly what you just said. Yes?
I think part of the issue is that, you know, when people are very busy, like especially all working people, we don't have so much time to read, and that's why we like to get a plot quickly. But when I have time, because I really enjoy reading, when I have time, then I love a slow-paced, story that where I can get all the juicy descriptions and think right into it.
Yes, absolutely. I couldn't agree with you more. It's like, that's the ultimate question that publishers have these days, is who has the time? Where are you going to find the time for that, you know, not slow-paced as much as relaxing into the reading. Everybody wants the Da Vinci Code on the MTR, you know, with the cliffhanger happening within two pages because I got to go to work or school or the next stop. Anyone else?
Like, if you have a very good story, then I think the timing should not matter. What does it matter if it's slow? because I think a good writer, a clever writer, should write in a way that it looks very fast-paced, but you're going very slow.
Absolutely.
I think that would be the best for you, I think.
More power to the South Asian spirit. That's what we do here.
No.
Sounds just like a public service announcement, right?
No. I just want, because we're, if you have a very good story, why does the pace and the timing matters? Because those who have time, they will pick it up. Those who don't have time will wait and read it on their pace.
Let me ask you a question. What is the South Asian story that you want to hear about, that you feel you don't know about? Now, this might come as a, what is she really talking about? Because what you know is what you know. But what is it that you feel that you don't know? Does anyone feel that there's a aspect of South Asia that you don't know about, that you'd like to hear about? Haven't thought about it?
South Asian as like has been too much generalized by those, if I wouldn't like to use that word exodus, but if you try to see like clearly in the past what happened in South Asia or anywhere in history or any thing. It always happens this with nature or even like animals, everything. So what we're trying to see is like when the South Asian spirit, which means whenever they say South Asian, mostly those who have traveled like to Canada, US or those type of things, it pops up like whenever, because South Asian is the word mostly used by those people, I think. Don't you agree? Like, I don't think like I'm South Asian, or unless someone oh, you're South Asian. Oh, okay, I didn't know I was South Asian until someone told me that I'm South Asian. So we see as a, like, not like a territory, like a person or... Like
you think it's a word that has been brought about because of the diaspora around the world?
Diaspora is a good word, but what I see, like, you're writing story from... You're in that position. Suppose you're in US or you're writing from this. Sometimes you have to come this side, not like a physical, but you really have to like see from this side so you have a very clear perspective. Because what you've written, I think, what I feel, I'm not sure, I haven't read that one, but what I see the general hang of it is that you've written Arya, who's in Los Angeles, right? Los Angeles or US?
San Francisco.
San Francisco, somewhere. So, and usually... I grew up reading those type of stories, so I have that hang of it. And so why it attracts these Asian is because they haven't lived that life. So how about like giving the other way, you change it and try to give it to the...
My story is actually all set in India.
Because even if it's set in India, the perspective should be very correct, I think. It doesn't matter where the location is, but when you say that one, in San Francisco, it might like tilt towards the more like, and you're not catering more towards the Asian. Like sometimes you have to really like.
Yeah.
I find it very boring. I'll say the correct word because I've been reading the same genre of whenever I was like young, like from their perspective all the time, and sometimes I wish, and why I stop reading book after certain, like I. After a certain time is that because all the Asian or South Asian or any writer give the same thing. There is nothing new.
The same thing as in?
As in like you went there and then like you have to really, I think it's time that...
I couldn't speak for other South Asian writers. You know, that wouldn't be the right thing to do. But... certainly, from my perspective, is that we, as I mentioned, for me, it's like I'm a storytelling ambassador of South Asia. So it's really bringing those stories to what is the rest of the world. Because the rest of the world doesn't know these stories, right? They have a very almost stereotypical view of what comes from that part of the world. And we do have a lot of stories to tell. Yeah. Anyone else? Yes.
If you look at South Asian stories, so what sells is the exotic part of it.
Yes.
The spices and maybe the guy who traveled to USA to succeed. But I would like to hear is, like a person who's succeeded in South Asia, a story about a strong woman. Because we don't hear those stories. I think, that's what is lacking because what we see more often, because what we see in publishing is what sells, so what people would want to read. I think maybe we should break those stereotypes.
That's an interesting one.
Yeah.
Are you talking fiction, nonfiction, doesn't matter?
Fiction, because even if you look at the recent sort of award-winning, even the Booker Prize, you know, the Indian, you know, books, again, it's the same genre, because when you read one and when you read the other, you know, okay, it's the same. Because what I see is because those books are written for an international audience, so when you write for maybe a Western audience, you have to sort of, you know, cater what they want to read. So I think there are far more interesting sort of themes within South Asia in terms of the diversity.
Contemporary themes, ancient themes?
Exactly, because again, what we see is we tend to go to the roots, but
right.
we tend to forget, you know, what's happening now. So I think there's more scope.
I think that's a great idea.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Thank you. Anyone else? Questions? Comments? Contributions? Yes.
I missed the first 10 minutes for this talk, so perhaps I didn't know your answer. Are you based in Hong Kong right now? Okay.
Yes.
If then, why do you publish your book mainly for Indian publisher rather than Hong Kong, or story about Hong Kong and Indian people in Hong Kong and things like that? Because I'm a publisher.
I see. Yes, I did say sort of earlier on in the presentation, my particular stories are very much Indian stories. And that is sort of my knowledge base, my imaginary world, I should say. In India, with the publishing industry, the scope is a lot, but a lot of what we have faced in India is something that you mentioned also a little bit earlier, is there are these books that are brought in from the outside. Okay, when I talk about English language, even actually in a vernacular in Hindi and the other languages, a lot of it translations of books brought in from the outside. So a lot of foreign authors, if I just look at my genres with nonfiction, a lot of nonfiction books brought in from the outside, young adult, the Harry Potters and the J.K. Rowlings, and all brought in from the outside. Whereas we have so many of our own stories, okay? And that was sort of my pet peeve. And I said before, I think about the rest of the world, you know, I want to bring these stories to our people first. So that was my starting point. For my next book that I'm working on, I'm actually thinking of not, what is the right way to say it, closing it necessarily to an Indian publisher. I haven't reached that level yet, but I have thought about it. Now, of course, these books, they are for sale in India, but certainly open to publishers outside to buy the rights, you know, if they feel that they would like it in their markets as well. So hopefully that answers your question somewhat.
Why don't you write something about Hong Kong?
I've been thinking about it. I have this long list of what I want to do. And believe me, it's on the list a lot. I've got two or three different ideas, but I haven't gotten to them yet because it's like I've got to finish project at a time. So I'm working on the specific book now, and when I finish that, then maybe, yeah. Anything else? Anyone? Yes.
How long does it take for you to write?
Oh my goodness, that is when Arya Fell Through the Fault took something like 3-4 years. Operation Mom, one summer. Some of my nonfiction books, I would say a year. You know, the nonfiction, I just approach it a different way because it's... I work in the nonfiction field every single day, so it's much more like outlining it and doing it. And because, you know, there's much less imagination, not much less, there is no imagination sort of involved. You know, it's much more fact and building around fact. It's just written in a different way, which in many ways I think is easier. Fiction is, I think, harder work because that really requires you to bring out more with imagination, with creativity, with the writing, and bringing things across. The storytelling aspect, I think, is much more intricate and much more complex and much more subjective in terms of style as well. So, can differ according to the project.
So you don't follow one path?
No, I don't. I don't follow one path, partly because me, myself, and I get bored with following one path. A lot of this, a friend of mine asked me recently, she said, you've written 7 books and you have a full-time job. How do you do it? Because you've got 2 kids, you got the dog, you got the husband, you've got parents to take care of all the stuff. And my answer to her was like, listen, I'm just bored of the daily domesticity. So I have to go and write the books because those guys, my family, they drive me crazy, you know. So, yes.
So my question was, you know, about that. So how do you sort of manage that and how do you juggle the balance?
I don't have a good answer for that. That's the one question I don't have a good answer for. if I tell you, I can talk about my life as it is right now, today. And then it's not exemplary. Let me start by saying that. Okay. Firstly, I should say, I write for no more than 2 hours in a day. I would love, love, love to have what I think is the luxury of spending all day writing, going to writing retreats, locking myself in a place where I don't see anyone. I really like seeing all of you, but seriously, don't take it personally. You know, I would love to just lock myself away and write. I just don't have the ability to do that in my life. I have a full-time job. I have extremely unreasonable hours. I wake up 60% of the time, 3:15 a.m. is when I set my alarm. 40% of the time, it's 2:15 a.m. So it just doesn't get better either way, any way you look at it. And I go to work, and I do a lot of writing at work. So I write every day at work, for work. And then I roughly finish work about noon or 1 o'clock, somewhere there. But I'm exhausted. So the rest of the day has to be managed between sort of taking a nap, exercising, taking care of children and family, and writing. So if I get 2 solid hours in, that's a huge luxury, huge luxury. And then, excuse me, I have to go to bed early because I have to wake up at 3:15 the next day. My life wasn't always like this, meaning I didn't always have to wake up at 3:15, but I did always pretty much have a full day. So I have never been able to write for more than 2 hours a day at any point. In some ways, I think that's okay, because at least you structure yourself, on a regular basis, and I know I have to get those 2 hours in. It's very important to get regularity into your writing practice. Different authors will say different things, but I think this one thing, you know, I've heard from many, many authors, because writing is like a muscle. If you don't exercise, you know, you lose muscle form, and the same thing with writing. It doesn't come out so polished if you've like left it for a while. So that regularity is very important. You're not going to produce a masterpiece each day. You're not going to produce final text to your manuscript each day. That's, you know, don't necessarily aspire towards that. But as long as you have that regularity every single day at whatever time you have set for yourself in your day, however your day looks or is shaped, that's the most important thing. My schedule hopefully is going to be changing soon, though. Other questions? Yes.
Hi. As you know, that in China, especially in the mainland, I mean the not so advanced city, we have a calling that leftover woman. Do you know that? Leftover woman means that a lady at 20s or the kind should to be married.
Yes.
Age, yeah. And if they at this age and they are single, they are kind of a lot of pressure from their family, and their parents will urge them to do the blind date or something like that. So I'm curious, that is, do they have the same the similar situation in South Asia?
I would say yes. I'd be curious to hear what my fellow South Asians say here. We don't call them leftover women. But we do treat them as leftover women, largely. You know, there is very much this pressure, and I think it happens quite young, in your 20s even, which I think is young, which in South Asia, well, that may not be so young, you know, where there is a lot of pressure to get them married. And it's interesting because when I wrote this book, this book is very much about the daughter setting up her mother on a blind date. Okay? I choose my words carefully because there's nothing about marriage in this. But immediately, when various publicity, you know, when the publicity rounds were happening for the book and whatever newspapers and press started interviewing me, they're like, but why does the daughter want to get the mother married? And I said, no, not married. We're not talking married here. And that in itself had to be delicately put across because it could be construed as culturally a little bit too much out there, you know? What is this dating stuff? You know, I mean, it's like too forward and too sort of not according to the norms of society and that kind of thing. There is very, very much this pressure for young women to immediately get married. You don't want to cross into your 30s and be unmarried because then you do become the leftover woman. There are a lot of women in their 30s who are not married, and increasingly so in urban centers, Mumbai, and not so much in the north, but Bangalore, you know, where a lot of working women were in centers of industry and things like that. So could you argue on one hand that the culture is getting used to it? I suppose you could, but once you dig in deeper, deeper, deeper and look into the layers, well, maybe not. You know, there's still these stigmatisms attached to that, you know, and still these psychological judgments which may not openly be said, but are very much there. Does anyone disagree with me? Other South Asians in the room? What do you think? No? Yeah?
Vedas and those histories. I want to know, just was like, since you were like versed, well versed in both sides, I just want to know what are the similarities you still find in rooted today? And like Ayurveda is quite old, right? Ancient things. And what things you still find is relevant, like you said, like for example, the Ramayana, like even those times, the gossip and those things happened, right? Even today, we have the same thing, right? So do you think, is it very ancient or is it very modern or is it just...
Ayurveda?
Like something like, just yeah. Comparison. Yeah.
Ayurveda, I am such a missionary for Ayurveda. Ayurveda is 5,000, 6,000, 7,000 years old. Somewhere there, we'll never know exactly, but somewhere there, right? And I get asked this question a lot. If it's such an old life science, how is it relevant today? Okay? And Ayurveda translates from Sanskrit as something like the science of life. It is very much, in a nutshell, about looking at your life and your lifestyle, your life patterns, your environment, and designing your lifestyle according to your environment so that you are always able to optimize your health. Now that's very specific and it might sound a little vague because when you get into it, what are those aspects of life and lifestyle that you must adjust? It's how you eat, it's how you live, it's what therapies you have, it's your self-care, your daily care every day that keeps you at a state of what is optimum health for you. When I say optimum health for you, means because your state of optimum health is different from mine, it's different from hers, it's different from his. If you look around the room, we all look different. We act differently. We have different likes and dislikes. Thank goodness, otherwise we'd all be robotic clones looking the same and the world would be a pretty boring place, right? So Ayurveda is very much about understanding your individualized state of optimum health because it's different from one person to the next. And once you understand what your state of optimum health is, then you can design your life given your parameters, your environment, and what is available to you to reach that optimum state of health every day to prevent you from falling sick or to come back onto a path of health if you have fallen sick. So Ayurveda is applicable to everyone every day at in every culture, in every stage of life. It's actually not ancient or modern. It's very much something that is adjusted through the course of life, through cultures, through geographies, and so forth. And it's wonderful to understand even its basic diagnostic tools, because if nothing else, it just gives you more information about yourself that you can take to your doctor and talk with your doctor about. Yeah? Okay, I am being given hand signals. Can we have one more question? I think she has one more question. Last question. Yes.
I just react to your answer. Just now you were talking about it. My sister is some kind of depression. I just wonder if you are, just now you mentioned your study, your mission about that. Do you think helpful for her or some kind of physical medicine?
Absolutely helpful. We treat a lot of depression in Ayurveda. The only thing I will say is it requires commitment. Okay, this unlike Western medicine where you take aspirin and your headache is cured, it doesn't work like that. It really requires commitment because whatever toxic matter the mind-body has accumulated needs to be loosened, liquefied, and then ejected, expelled out of the body, of the physical body. Okay? Thank you so much, everyone. It's been wonderful having you here today. Wonderful to have your participation. And yeah, if you'd like some books, I have some. I'm happy to sign them or to chat further. All up to you. Okay? Thank you so much. Enjoy the book fair.